Good afternoon, everybody. It's the next episode of The Silver Linings Librarian with Miss Coviello. I'm going to be reading chapters 4, 5, and 6 of the wonderful book by Sid Fleischman called The Whipping Boy. I hope you'll be reading along with me. When we left off, Prince Brat and Jemmy were running away. Well, Prince Brat wanted to run away, but Jemmy didn't want to go with him because nobody liked Prince Brat. Well, let's see what happens when they get out into the real world. This is called Chapter 4, Containing Hands in the Fog. The night moon had lit their way like a lantern, but by dawn the runaways, double mounted on a horse from the castle stable, were hopelessly lost. A thick fog had swirled in, and they'd strayed from the roads, and trees had closed in on them. "Forest is creepy thing," said Jemmy, hanging onto the basket as best he could. "Give me cobbled streets any time." A low branch almost swept them off the saddle. "Boy," said the prince, "get down and lead this dumb-headed beast." "Lead it? In this fog? I'd need two hands and a lantern to find me own nose." But Jemmy slipped off the saddle. A plan had been tumbling about in his head. "Here's your chance, Jemmy," he told himself. "Slip away in the fog. Run for it. No more whippings for you. Not if you can't be found. The great sewers, Jemmy. That's the place to hide." "What's keeping you?" asked the prince. "Grab the halter." "I'm thinking." Leaves crackled under Jemmy's feet as he began to back off. His mind was made up. Once the fog cleared, he'd find the river. Hadn't his paw taught him his way through the maze of mighty brick sewers? That's where they'd caught the fiercest rats to sell by the cageful. The dog and rat pits paid fancy prices for the best fighters, and that meant sewer rats. Who'd think to look for Jemmy under the city? Jemmy took another crackling step backward and froze. A sudden yellow glow floated in the fog. The prince burst into squawks and bellows. "Who's there? Let go! Take your hands off me, you insolent rascal!" There came a great, rough, booming reply. "Well, what we got here?" The lantern swayed. "A noisy brat on a fine beast of a horse." Jemmy edged closer. A cutthroat, he thought. Like a snake striking, a ghostly hand darted through the fog and clutched his arm. A second cutthroat. Jemmy looked up and barely made out a long, bony face with hollow cheeks and a nose like a meat cleaver. "I got another, Billy," cackled the second man, shoving Jemmy forward. Chapter 5. Hold Your Nose, Billy, and Cutwater. Billy pulled Prince Brat from the saddle and threw him into Jemmy. Raising the lantern, the man held it close enough that Jemmy could feel the heat of the flame. Billy was a big man, he saw, big and raw as a skinned ox, and he smelled like a ton of garlic. "Not much of a catch. 2 sparrows, said Billy. "But ain't they trimmed up in fancy rags, Cutwater?" "Ain't they?" echoed the rattle-boned man. "Got any gold in your pockets, lads?" "No business of yours," snapped the prince. "Oh, but so help me, it is my business," Billy said with a thunderclap of laughter. "Don't you know who I am?" "A clod and a ruffian," declared the prince. "Worse than that," corrected the big man. "Ain't you never heard of Hold Your Nose, Billy?"
"Famous he is," put in Cutwater. "Put to song is Billy."
Jemmy thought he remembered. Hadn't he heard ballad sellers fling that name about the streets? The exploits of Hold Your Nose something or other in verses by the yard. "The highwayman, are you?" "The same." "The murderer?" "Only in the line of duty," Hold Your Nose Billy chuckled. "So you won't mind if we take your horse and empty your pockets."
"Not a copper between us," said Jemmy. A prince didn't carry money, for he had no use for it, and Jemmy's accounts were kept on the books.
"What's in the basket?" piped up Cutwater. "Hands off, villain," snapped Prince Brat. "Don't you know who I am?"
Jemmy gave the prince a sudden jab of his elbow to keep his mouth shut. "Not a word." But the heir to the throne raised himself to his full height.
"Bow to your prince."
Frog swirled around the lantern.
"Bow to what?" asked Cutwater. "I am Prince Horace."
And I'm the Grand Turnip of China, Cutwater snickered. Dim-witted villains, shouted the prince. I command you to turn us loose, or Papa will hang the pair of you in chains. Hold your trap, Jemmy thought. Don't you have a thimbleful of brains? A prince would make a fine catch for these rogues. Me friend's muddle-headed, he declared. His paw's nothing but a rat-catcher, but don't he put on airs, though. Got enough lip for two sets of teeth, chortled the big highwayman. Cutwater, take the lantern and fetch the horse. What do you reckon's in the basket, Billy? Plenty of time to find out. The lantern floated off. The evil-smelling Billy clutched each boy hard by the ear. Stir your legs! Walk! And don't let me catch you on our turf again. Do I make myself clear? Clear as window glass, said Jemmy with a sigh of relief. If you'd be kind enough to point us toward the river, I'd be ever so much obliged. Billy! Came a shout from Cutwater. They ain't just common sparrows. Have a look at this saddle. Hold your nose, Billy, hung onto the boy's ears. It hit the horse's side. Cutwater was holding the lantern close to the saddle. Skin me alive, declared the big man in awe. That's the king's own crest. We stole it, the horse and the saddle, Jemmy put in desperately. Bosh, retorted Prince Bat scornfully. Didn't I tell you who I was? Bow low, you fools, and be off. But the two men neither bowed nor fled. Hold your nose, Billy, threw a bushy-eyed glance at his fellow outlaw. Cutwater, what do you reckon a genuine prince on the hoof is worth? His weight in gold, at least, Billy. Chapter 6, in which the plot thickens. Wisps of fog clung like tattered rags to the trees, and then the forest cleared. But so thick were the pines that the morning sun barely touched the ground. Hold your nose, Billy pushed aside a low branch, revealing a rickety timbered hut with a moldy thatch roof. There's our castle, your young majesty, said, chuckling. Accept our hospitality. I hope you won't mind sleeping on the floor. The floor was hard-packed earth. Braided garlic bulbs hung like knotted ropes from the rafters. I'm hungry, announced Prisbrat. And feast you will, said Hold Your Nose, Billy. Cutwater, serve 'em up our finest bread and herring. Jemmy had made many a meal on bread and herring when he was in luck. He felt hungry enough to ask for seconds. Prince Brat bared his teeth. I'd sooner eat mud. He reached for the wicker's basket, but Cutwater snatched it back. What we got here? Muttered the bone-thin man and threw back the lid. Roll your eyes at this, Billy. Meat pies, looks like, and fruit tarts, and a brace of roast pheasant. We'll eat like kings. Hands off, that's mine, the prince cried. Was yours, yapped Cutwater. Locks, Jemmy thought. Hadn't the prince run away in royal style? He'd even brought a china plate, a silver spoon, and a silver knife just for himself. Digging around deeper in the basket, the garlicky outlaw called out to Cutwater, Bring the lantern closer. What's this? In the gloom of the hut, the big man lifted out a golden crown. That's mine, bleated the prince. Was yours, corrected Hold Your Nose Billy, placing the crown on the tangled red nest of his hair. Prince, hold your nose, Billy, Cutwater burst out joyously. He began to scratch himself as if his shirt was crawling with fleas, which Jemmy thought it probably was. We're dog rich. That crown? A trifle, scoffed Hold Your Nose, Billy. We can be richer and dog rich. That empty-headed prince, Jemmy thought. Why had he brought along his crown? To put it on his head and expect vagabonds and cutthroats to fall to their knees? The big, raw-faced outlaw grabbed Prince Brat off the ground and took the heft of him as if he were weighing a sack of potatoes. 55 pounds, by me reckoning, he said. We'll write the king a command, Cutwater. 55 pounds of gold coin in trade for his royal tadpole. So that concludes chapter 6. I hope you're enjoying it as much as I am. Love this book. Full of interesting things to learn and talk about, such as the time it takes place, which I believe to be the Renaissance or Middle Ages, and also lots to discuss about the personal problems, personality traits, character traits of Prince Brat. To be continued next time.